Good morning, everyone. Welcome to HeapCon day two. Time to open up the grid track. And please give a warm welcome to Dr. Milan Milanović. He'll be talking to us today about software architectures. Take it away.
Is it working? Yeah, okay. Thank you for coming to my talk today. We will talk about software architectures in one maybe unusual way, about some, let's say, topic which is not so often mentioned. Let me introduce myself. I'm Milan. I have around 20 years of experience in this field. I worked in different positions, different roles, different companies. And I'm currently working in one US startup as a CTO. When people ask me what I do at startup, I do a lot of things, but it is interconnection of people, processes, technology, business, so really different kinds of stuff. I also write a lot, mostly on some, let's say, social networks. Also, I write my newsletter. You can subscribe here if you want. And I have around 10 million of readers every month. So let's talk about our today's subject. This is, let's say, software architecture. And of course, the question is, what is software architecture? Is it diagrams? So when we show some, let's say, architectural diagrams, can we say, OK, this is, let's say, architecture of our solution? Or maybe it is how we, let's say, structure our code, which architectural patterns we use, which architectural styles. Or maybe something we will do later. This is something which we can see a lot with MVPs. So we start doing, and then later we will define our architecture. Or maybe none of this, all of this. I like this quote from Ralph Johnson, one of the authors of Design Patterns book, that architecture is about important stuff, whatever that is. And when we talk about goals of software architecture, we want first to enable efficient delivery of features to our end users and stakeholders, and of course, to get feedbacks and close feedback loop from them to us, to our team. And how we can do, let's say, software architectures. First, we want to translate why and what to how and verify that. And of course, to enable different requirements and system qualities through taking some larger technical decisions. And but the question is, who takes those decisions? Are there some just guys who called architects, who are sitting somewhere and giving us some decisions? I would say that everyone is taking these decisions. And you, as a developer, every day take many decisions how to do something, balancing between different options. And here I want to present one decentralized approach to architecture, where anyone can do architecture. You just need to do two things. And the first thing is, let's say, to contact experts in some particular fields which you don't know. And the other thing is to also contact with people who are affected by your decisions. And what about the mindset when we talk about architecture? We want to have a holistic view on our system in some context and its interconnections. And when we talk about the mindset, we talk here about we need to have architectural thinking. And what this means? This means that we need to know different technology options, how to balance those trade-offs, what are the pros and cons of those options, and also to understand the business in a way that we want to map the business with the least complexity to systems we create. And I also want to argue one more thing, that architect is not a job. You will probably notice that there are some software architect roles offered in some companies, but I would say that architect is a role. So anyone from the senior members of the team can do and should do architecture. Why? Because with this, we decentralize approach of taking architectural decisions and important decisions. And also, we encourage people and motivate them to, let's say, work better inside that project. But what is at the core of architectural work? Is it like some architectural patterns, styles, maybe how we do, which technology we choose, or something else? I would say it's communication. And the most important job of every software architect is communication. And the best architects I worked with are not the, let's say, people who know, let's say, technology the best, but the best communicators. Master communicators. Without the good communication, you cannot have good architectures. And the question is how we communicate our architecture. There are multiple, let's say, ways how we can do it. First thing is, of course, narrative, storytelling, especially when talking with non-technical people, different kinds of presentations to them. Then, architectural documentation. We will talk a bit more about this later. Of course, diagrams, which is the most popular way. Then different stakeholder-specific presentations, depending are those, let's say, stakeholders more technical than more technical presentations. If not so technical, then less technical presentations. And of course, then hands-on workshops where we maybe show our POCs or some prototypes we did. And of course, feedback loops where we want to, let's say, hear and encourage discussion and let's say, feedback from other people. But why should we document software architecture a lot? There are some people who say we shouldn't do this. And in the poll I saw for today's presentation that, let's say, half of the people don't have any architectural documentation. And the thing is that the code don't tell everything. What the code don't tell? What are the goals of our system? Let's see, what are some non-functional let's say attributes of our system, and also what are some decisions maybe that we made which produced, let's say, such code later. And goals of our architecture architecture documentation are to have common understanding. What this means, we want to bring the gap between product and development, mostly here. Then to evaluate our architecture. Did our architecture, let's say, meet the goals we had? Also, of course, to support knowledge sharing inside and outside our team. Then it helps to implement the solution. Why? Because before implementing, we need to know some constraints to have some architectural decisions before we can go and implement. And let's say, when we talk about architecture documentation, the first thing are, of course, diagrams, which is the, let's say, most popular thing to represent it. And they help us in making, let's say, different processes presented. And when we talk about diagrams, the question is, do we need standards or some standard notations when we talk about diagrams? Why is this question? For example, if I show you a diagram of one solution like this, can you tell me what is it about? What are those, let's say, arrows, shapes, boxes? Are those arrows like relationships or maybe data flows or maybe something else? I saw many diagrams like this on some projects, and then like when you came to the project, you need to figure it out. What is this about? Then you see different layers of abstraction. You see some abstract stuff, then you see some technologies also. So it's a pretty, let's say, mess up. For example, this diagram is our current solution diagram, a little bit simplified. With the legend, and when you see a diagram like this, you will probably figure it out very fast what is it about and how it is working. And when we talk about diagram types today, what I see are mostly two things. UML is still here, and of course C4 model, which is a bit newer. And when we talk about UML, it is pretty old, let's say, specification. I read once, I think it has 800 pages, this specification, and like 10, 15 years ago, we used it a lot. So we used all types of diagrams to show different kinds of, let's say, parts of our system. But today, what I see, that we mostly use these three kinds of diagrams, like class, sequence, and state diagrams. And that's it. And I think this is probably the best what we took from the UML. And then, like five years ago, came this C4 model from Simon Brown. It's a framework to visualize our software architecture on different levels of abstraction, from context through containers, components, and code. On the system context diagram, this is system context diagram of our current solution. You can see, our customer, our system in the center, and then external systems are these gray boxes. Then if we zoom in our system in the center, we are at container diagram. Here we see, different individual services or applications in our system, even databases, and you can see how it looks like. Then if we want to zoom in one of those services, then we look at the component diagram. In component diagram, we can see different stuff like components, facades, controllers, so different kinds of components. And this diagram is more to be used by developers or architects. Then if we zoom in one of the components, we arrive at code level. And code we can present like with class UML class diagrams or entity relationship diagrams or something similar. What are some diagramming good practices? Choose optimal number of diagrams. What this means? This means that you cannot have complex system with one diagram, or vice versa, some simple system with a lot of diagrams. You just need to use common sense. I saw both variants of this. Be consistent across diagrams, especially if you use non-standard notations. So if you use arrow shapes, boxes in the similar semantics in one diagram, use it also in other diagrams. Don't confuse the reader. Then we want to have traceability. What this means, like in your source control systems, we want to have possibility to see changes and history of changes of your diagram. And of course, it is nice to have legends. They explain a bit more semantics of your diagram. And also try to be simple. You just one font with two sizes and just straight lines if possible, not other ways. So because more simple, it's easier to read and comprehend. But let's say diagrams are not all. We need something more. You cannot read everything for diagrams. And we need documentation too. And when I say this, we need to have something I call a high documentation culture. Even though it is not, well accepted, I think it is very, very important. When we talk about software architecture documentation, we think mostly around these two things. First is request for comments, and the other one is architectural decision records. There are some other things, but I selected just to talk about these two because they are most important. Request for comments are written proposals that seek feedback and encourage discussions about some technical discussions, technical decisions and implications. And one usual request for comment document looks like this. So you have some kind of a summary, scope, who are participants, what status is, and the main thing, proposal. What we proposed with this RFC. Then pros and cons of our approach. What are possible alternatives to our approach, which is a very important section. Sometimes after, some rounds, maybe we select something there from alternatives. And what are open questions? And of course, conclusion. And how we sometimes it is called solution design document. And the process goes like this. So we have some topic. We create a request for comments. Then we call other people to give comments and feedback. And after a few rounds of feedback, we come with the final conclusion and decision. The other one are architectural decision records. Those are lightweight documents usually stored in source code near to the topics which they describe. Those are documents that capture important, architectural decisions in some context. So we want to say, okay, in this context, facing something, we decided for this option to achieve something, and we accepted some downsides. Why is this very important? Because some people who are maybe here or maybe will come later after you, they will ask you why you selected this or why you did this. Then if you have architectural decision records, they can go and check why you let's say selected those options. Very, very important document. But how we can structure all of this documentation? Some let's say teams have some of these documents, but they are just scattered all around. So something is in source code, something is in Confluence, something is even local machines. It's just a mess up. One way to structure this documentation is this ARC42 template. It is a lightweight template for documenting and communicating system software architectures. It supports different tools and technologies, and it is completely process independent. It can be used in any process and any project. It consists of different fields, from, of course, requirements, then external systems, then your core idea solution, then different kinds of views on your system from source code to deployment view. Cross-cutting concepts, of course, here architectural decision records, also quality requirements, then technical depth and glossary. So all important things which are the view on your software architecture are contained in this document. The other way how you can describe this is this architecture canvas. This is pretty fresh. I think this Patrick Ross created this, this summer. I like it very well because it is per business case. So per business case, you can describe functions, quality goals, some your hypothesis in some business context, and of course, different kinds of constraints and challenges. So it describes what the software should do, how can we do it, and how do we evaluate our solution. It also maps really well with the ARC42. These blue sections are from the ARC42, so it can go along with ARC42. And also with C4 model, this business context maps directly to a system context diagram of C4 model. But that's not all. So we have diagrams, we have documentation, but we need something else. What is it? And we need to talk also. Why? Because you cannot take all important decisions just by documenting stuff and go through let's say, documents. Sometimes you need first to talk about some, let's say, topics. And what we do, usually, we have this weekly architectural meeting or bi-weekly, it depends. On the team, which is actually a place for conversation on architectural technology topics, where we discuss spikes, challenges, let's say some decisions we want to make. And it is important because sometimes here we decide should we continue with the process or not. And here is our current architecture decision framework, how it looks like for example, one requirement. So we have some requirement which came. Then we go through these discussions around it. Some discussions led to request for comment document, which we of course create and get feedback in the feedback loop. What we do also when we write a request for comment, we include two things, our internal tech reader. You can also use ThoughtWorks tech reader or some other, and also some tech standards. What are tech standards? Those are internal stuff, how we do logging, how do we exception handling, how we do testing, and similar stuff. So these two things are incorporated in RFC before the conclusion. Then, when we finish with RFC, we create architecture decision record, and then we go to implementation. What are some common documentation mistakes I saw? Of course, no documentation. This is something you will see a lot, and especially with newcomers who just complain, okay, I don't have any docs. You know, I need to talk with someone, but this guy is always busy. You know, he doesn't have time to talk with me. Then outdated documentation. This is a bit better, not too much, but it's still better than not having any documentation. Then lack of structure. This is the thing that you can use, for example, ARC42. You have documentation, but it's just scattered all around. And of course, lack of consistency. What this means? This means that for some parts of the system we have good docs, but for some parts we don't any. So this is also something we don't want. We want to have, let's say, documentation at least for core systems we have in our software solution. And of course, let's talk about tools that you can use. There are two groups of tools here, diagramming tools and modeling tools. When we talk about diagramming tools, we have tools like DiagramsNet, earlier called Drew.io, which we use a lot, Lucidchart, Excalidru, and some others. And then modeling tools, like Enterprise Architecture for C4 Model and Star UML, which are a bit better. Why? Because they are more versatile, where you create models, which can be also architecture as code models. So you can store those models in your source control systems and then generate different kinds of views and different kinds of diagrams on those models. If you are interested more in these tools, you have this site, Software Architecture Doc Tools, where you can see all of these modeling, diagramming, and architecture as code tools presented. For you who want to learn more and introduce all of these things more in your, let's say, teams and projects, there are a few books that I can recommend. Software Architecture for Developers by Simon Brown, which talk mostly about a C4 model. Then Docs for Developers book, where you have good, let's say, notes how to write really good documentation. And around that, ARC42, of course, book. This book documenting software architecture is a bit old, but can give you a good foundations on this topic. And of course, new book Communication Patterns, which is released last month, that will bring you some maybe fresh ideas to this topic. Okay, that would be it from my side. Thank you all. Okay, questions, if any.
Okay, so which languages do you use to create the diagrams? Like programming languages specifically crafted for creating diagrams. And what is your experience with using ChatGPT to create those, to generate?
Programming languages for creating diagrams. There are some, libraries which you can use because I'm coming from this .NET world. I use some of those tools for ChatGPT. I never tried really for diagramming because I think it didn't have support for diagramming until maybe recently. So didn't try it for this thing. No. Well, if you follow me on the let's say different networks, you know that I favor it very much because we passed a decade of let's say microservices only architecture, so even small projects are immediately created like in microservices architecture, and then all different kinds of problems. So what I recommend always is if you have a let's say MVP or small project, always start with the model monolith that can be later split into microservices or some other architecture if you let's say need it. Tomorrow, if your solution grows so much. Okay, someone else?
If anyone has any more questions, you can catch them during the conference day. So you have 15 minutes break, and then we'll be talking about DevOps. Thank you, Milan.
Okay. Thank you.